Hello students, yesterday we have studied about nuclear forces and nature of nuclear forces, what is exchange forces and how they generates means and how the stability of nucleus can be understood in the form of nuclear forces and how Yukawa explained that. All the things I have explained you completely yesterday. Today let's study about nuclear reactions. So first, what is nuclear reaction? It is observed that if any nucleus is bombarded by some particles, then if this is heavy nucleus, as I told you that if nucleus is unstable, then to attain the stability, it follows different part. It also follows the process of radioactivity, or it follows the process of splitting of its nucleus. Means simple, in the case of radioactivity, as alpha, beta, gamma rays are emitted in from the nucleus, and due to that, with the help of that, it can attain its stability. So in the same manner, if there is instability in the nucleus, then nucleus will try to attain its stability, and it will be also have the tendency to be in a stable condition. So for that, if it splits into two or more parts, and also as you have seen that light nuclei and heavier nuclei both are very unstable, and nuclei between light and heavier, they are stable in comparison to lighter and heavier nuclei. So nuclei follows two more methods to attain its stability. Like lighter nuclei follow the process of fusion, means the process of mixing of two or more nuclei, and they convert it into the heavier nuclei to attain the stability. And heavier nuclei split up two or more stable nuclei to attain the stability. So that both processes can be are used for by the nucleus to attain its stability. So simple, what is first nuclear reaction? In nuclear reaction, if a nucleus is nucleus of any atom is bombarded by any particle, means high energetic particle, so due to this high energetic particle, this particle will transmit its energy to the nucleus, meant it will transmit its energy to overcome the binding energy of the nucleus, and due to that the bonds between nucleons will break out, and the nucleus can be split up into two or more parts. So according to it, so if a nucleus of any atom is bombarded by some high energetic means high velocity particle, and due to that its bond energy break down, and obviously if it will, it can split into two or more parts, and in the splitting of nucleus there can be some emission of other particles and some energy. So in every nuclear reaction we always get some energy. Either it will be the case of splitting, or it will be the case of fusion. So means the energy equal to the binding energy that will be emitted out from the nucleus, and as you know that the binding energy is the order of a mega electron volt. So definitely in this process a large amount of energy is emitted from it, and that energy is sufficient to cause many distortion, or you know the case of atom bomb, and also means there are the scale of energy is quite high. It can destroy any city, means or simple, in the case of nuclear fusion the amount of energy released can even destroy our whole earth. Means nuclear energy, the strength of nuclear energy are of such types. As you know that the strength of nuclear energy nearly 10^38 times greater than the gravitational energy, and it is 100 times greater than electrostatic energy. So that energy is sufficient to cause any effect on any city or any planet. Or also this energy can be used in our domestic cases, like for our the problem of electricity can be solved easily from it if we will use it in the controlled way. So simple, it means that if any nucleus is splitted in two or more parts, then some amount of energy is released that will be equal to the binding energy of the nucleus or nucleons. So clear, I think, is that it is called nuclear reaction. Also, nuclear reaction is other which in which two or more nuclei add them and convert it into some other heavier nuclei, and some emission of some energy takes place. So this process is also the process of nuclear reaction. So it means that according to that, nuclear reactions are of two types. Basically, actually there are of course so many types, but here you have to study only two cases. First is nuclear splitting of nucleus, that is known as nuclear fission, and addition of nucleus means mixing of nucleus, that is known as nuclear fusion. So we have to study these two cases here. So for what is nuclear fission, as I have told you, that splitting of nucleus is known as nuclear fission, means the splitting of nucleus in the some lighter stable nuclei and with the radiation of some energy is known as nuclear fission. So I think nuclear fission is simple, clear to you. We can understand it by one example also. If this uranium-235 is bombarded by a fast moving neutron, then due to bombardment, this uranium-235 is split into two atoms, which is barium and krypton, and also it follows by emission of three neutrons and some amount of energy, which is in the order of mega electron volt, means a sufficient large amount of energy is evolved in this case. So this is the case of nuclear fission, in which a heavier nuclei is splitting into lighter nuclei with the release of some particles and energy. So I think simple nuclear fission is clear to you. So based on nuclear fission, we can use this energy, and to use this energy, we have to even control this reaction. As you have seen, you are seeing that in this process, three neutrons are emitting, and if there are large number of uranium atoms, then through the disintegration of one uranium, there can be emission of three neutrons, and we need only one neutron for the emission for the splitting. So it means that these three electrons will be will cause some disintegration of other uranium atoms, means only if we will start the bombardment of by one neutron on the one uranium atom, then automatically the other reactions will be started, means these emitted neutrons will again cause disintegration in other uranium atom, and there will be again a splitting of uranium atom will take place, again emission of neutrons will take place, means a number of neutrons will be emitted by this process, and that number of neutrons will again cause the disintegration in uranium, means a chain reaction will be started, which will never end until the this fuel, this uranium atom will end. Means if there are 100 number of uranium atom, then the reaction will started from one uranium atom, then it will be continually goes on until the 100 uranium atoms are disintegrated into barium and krypton. After the disintegration of whole of the uranium atom, the reaction will be will stop, and until in that process every time when uranium atom is disintegrated into barium and krypton, the high amount of energy, large amount of energy will be emitted, and that energy will be multiplied every time when all uranium atoms are disintegrating, and means due to uncontrolled reaction here, a large amount of energy will be produced within some seconds, within some minutes, and that will cause a huge impact on any things. Like as we know the case of atom bomb, this process is used, this uncontrolled process is used in to make the atom bombs. Because in atom bomb, use the as a fuel uranium or plutonium, and when it triggered by any simple, if triggered by one high energetic neutron, then after triggering, obviously it will be converted into this and three neutrons will be emitted, and these three neutrons are enough to cause further disintegration in uranium. And again means there will be the disintegration of uranium will be started continuously, and it will be increased without, mean increased to large area. You can understand it by one person. Suppose that this is uranium and we are finding some neutron on it. So there will be emission of three neutrons will take place, clear? After that, these three neutrons can again cause the splitting of uranium, and again three neutrons will be emitted. As you are seeing that in the two disintegration, nine neutrons are emitted, and these nine neutrons will again emit 27 neutrons, and means that it will increase to, it will expand to a large area, this amount of energy. And obviously in every disintegration, a large amount of energy of the order of mega electron volt will be emitted, and that is sufficient to cause a huge problem or a huge explode on in some city or other things. So that's why we know the effect of atom bomb when America used it in the Second World War to bombard on Japan. So and we know the problem arises due after that and also at that time. So this uncontrolled reaction is very harmful for us. Means if we want, we have to use this in our daily life, then we have to control this number of neutron. So the controlled reaction is used in the nuclear reactor. Uncontrolled reaction is used in making atom bomb, but the controlled reaction is used to used in nuclear reactors to produce electricity and to use it in our daily life. Means we have to reduce the number of electrons after the emission of after the splitting of uranium atom into baryon and krypton. Suppose that simple here due to bombardment of one neutron, three neutrons are emitted. So if by any process we absorb two of the neutrons are absorbed, then only one neutron will be left. And due to one neutron, it will cause the disintegration in only one uranium atom. Means not in three uranium atom, it will cause disintegration in one uranium atom. Again, due to one uranium atom, again three neutrons will be caused. And again, we have to use the process to absorb two neutrons. And for that, many processes are used. Actually, retarders are used in the nuclear reactors. By the absorption process of neutrons, we can control the reaction. We can use only one neutron at one time for the disintegration, and with that, this energy will be constant, and we can use this energy in our daily life. So I think nuclear reactor and control and uncontrolled chain reactions is now clear to you, as it forms a form of chain. So that's why we can call it chain reaction. So uncontrolled chain reaction is used in making atom bomb and the explosive atoms and bombs, and controlled chain reactions are used in nuclear reactors to produce the electricity, and or also in many ways we use it. So I think it is simple, clear to you. So the next topic is nuclear fusion. As I told you that to attain the stability, nucleus follow both types of processes. First is nuclear fission, means process of splitting of nucleus, and second is process of joining of nucleus. And in the process of splitting of nucleus, as I have told you that we use some high energetic particle to bombard on it, and due to bombardment it is split up into two or more particles with emission of some electron particles and emission of a huge amount of energy. So in nuclear fusion process, two or more nuclei are joined together, and due to their joining, a large amount of energy is also emitted in this case, because if they will be joined, then there will be some burning energy means that energy will be emitted. Actually, in this case, we are going to bring closer to two or more nuclei against their electrostatic the process of electrostatic repulsion. As you know that when two nuclei are come brought to closure at a closure distance, then there is 0.8 Fermi distance. The force on the nucleus is repulsive, and with decrement in distance, it also the repulsive power of force is increasing. So we have to overcome that repulsion also, and means after overcome of that repulsion, two nuclei can bring close together and they will be joined together. So we have to add a sufficient amount of energy to overcome that repulsive force, as the magnitude of repulsive force is very high, because as you know that the strength of nuclear force is very high, so obviously magnitude of repulsive force will be also high. So to overcome this high strength nuclear repulsive force, we have to add a high amount of energy. Means to start this process, we need a sufficient energy near about 10^7 degree Celsius temperature is needed to start this reaction. And if that energy is provided to it, then after that two nuclei can overcome the repulsive power of nucleus and they will be joined they will form some heavier nuclei with emission of energy and some particles. So in lighter nuclei, this process is basically achieved, because as you know that if lighter nuclei can change it into heavier nuclei, then heavier nuclei are stable in comparison to lighter nuclei. As I told you that stability curve and packing fraction, so through the stability curve or binding energy per nucleon curve, we have seen that lighter nuclei and heavier nuclei are more unstable than the nuclei between them. So lighter nuclei try to attain their stability by the process of nuclear fusion, and heavier nuclei try to attain the stability by the process of nuclear fission. So if there is sufficient energy or sufficient temperature provided, then two nuclei will be joined and they will form some. So hydrogen is a fuel of our stellar bodies. This process is also responsible for the energy of stellar bodies like sun, energy of sun and other. Means the source of energy of sun is this process, nuclear fusion. So in, as you know that in stellar body there is presence of hydrogen as a fuel. So two or more hydrogen atoms are joined together and they form some other heavier atom with the emission of some particles and energy. Means every time when they will be joined to, then some energy will be emitted. Again, this can be joined, the 1H2 with some 1H1 hydrogen, and that will be formed 2HE3, and there will be some energy emission can take place. Means nuclear fusion in stellar bodies can be take place in three ways. First, two primary hydrogen can be joined together to form this. This hydrogen can join together to the to form this. This means also these two hydrogens can be joined together to form this. So finally, if you will add these three processes by left and right, then we can get four hydrogen. Means if four hydrogen primary hydrogen atom are joined together and at a sufficient temperature, then they will be converted into helium atom, and there will be emission of some particles takes place with a huge amount of energy will be emitted from here. This energy will be added and that will be get nearly 26.7 mega electron volt. This is very high energy in comparison to nuclear fusion. Actually, in nuclear fusion process, there is large amount of energy is emitted than the nuclear fusion. Means if the hydrogen bomb is based on this process, so as you have seen the case of atom bomb can destroy a whole city, hydrogen bomb can destroy whole planet. So you can assume, you can think that how much amount of energy is emitted in this case, means it can destroy the whole planet easily. But we are safe in the way that we have no tools to produce such a great amount of energy, 10^7 degree Celsius, to start the fusion process. Means fusion process can be started only on this temperature, sufficient temperature, because it have to overcome the repulsive power of nucleus. Nuclear repulsive force means if the two nuclei will be come closer, then after that they will be joined, and if they will come closer, then definitely repulsive nuclear forces will repel them. So if we have to put them together, then definitely we have to add some external energy to for the reaction. So in the stellar bodies, as this amount of energy is present, so that's why with the help of this energy, two hydrogen atom can be fused, and easily nuclear fusion process can be takes place, and we are getting energy continuously from them until the whole hydrogen atom will be converted into the helium atom. After that, according to its mass, it will be converted into white dwarf or neutrons, stars, or black holes, etc. So it depends on the mass of the star. So means simple, until it has fuel, it has hydrogen, it will emit energy. There will be process of nuclear fusion will be continually takes place, because there is sufficient amount of temperature to cause this, to start this fusion. So that's why in stellar bodies continuously nuclear fusion process is going on, and we are getting continuous energy from the sun. So I think the process of nuclear fusion is clear to you. In this process, two or more nuclei are joined together, and a huge amount of energy is emitted from here. So if nuclear fusion, nuclear fission is clear to you, then definitely I think the difference between both of them is now also clear to you. Simple is that in process of nuclear fission, there is splitting of nuclei takes place. In process of nuclear fusion, there is joining of nuclei takes place. Simple. In the case of fission, we use high energetic particles to bombard on it. In the case of fusion, we have to bring closure to two nuclei, and after that we have to add some energy for the fusion process. In the fission process, in both processes there is emission of energy takes place, but in nuclear fission process we don't need extra energy we don't have to provide extra energy for the starting of a reaction. We need only high energetic particle, we have to bombard it on the target nucleus. But in the case of nuclear fission, we need a sufficient amount of energy. After that, nuclear fusion process will take place. Clear, I think, simple, the difference between nuclear fission and fusion is also clear. The amount of energy emitted in case of nuclear fusion is greater than, much greater than the nuclear fission. I think all the things are now clear to you. So in the case of nuclei, you have to study what the properties of nucleus, nuclear forces, and also how they can attain stability. Actually, there are so many ways to attain stability, and nucleus also so many ways, like radioactivity, nuclear fusion, nuclear fission, according to their need. And according to with the their miss, it depends on their mass, their unstable condition, and the different conditions they attain the process. Means if heavier nuclei are bombarded by some high energetic particle, then it can show nuclear fission. If there is sufficient energy somewhere, then nuclear fusion can start. And if nothing is there, then radioactive process can be observed in the case of unstable nuclei. And with the help of alpha, beta, gamma, they can convert themselves into the stable nuclei. So the next topic in this chapter is stability of nucleus with the help of number of protons and number of neutrons. We can also, as I told you, that with the help of binding energy per nucleon, we can tell the which is atom is more stable or which nucleus is more stable or which is less stable. And also with the help of packing fraction, I've told you that with the help of number of protons and number of neutrons, we can also tell it. Actually, it is observed that for the equal number of protons and neutrons, means the atoms which have equal number of proton and neutron, they are more stable than the other atoms which have the difference in the protons or neutrons. This is the curve obtained for the between the number of protons and number of neutrons. This is known as valley of stability. And if we will draw a curve for equal number of neutron and proton in the atoms or in the any nuclei, then we see that it nearly it is in the same manner as the valley of stability. It means that the nuclei which have same number of neutrons and protons are most stable in the other cases, means they show exceptional stability than the other atom. Now, like we have so many examples, suppose that this is 8 oxygen 16. In this, number of neutron is 8 and number of proton is also 8. Means they follow n equal to z and they show more stability than the atoms which can have greater difference between number of protons and neutrons. So in lighter atoms, as we have seen, that which atoms are most stable in the normal process, then they have equal number of neutrons and protons. And with increase in atomic number, number of neutrons increases, and due to sufficient increase in number of neutrons, means higher will be the number of neutrons than the number of protons, greater will be the instability in the nucleus. So we can define stability and instability in terms of number of neutrons and protons also. Means if they will be equal in number, then stability of the nuclei will be greater. But if they are, and there will be difference in their numbers, means if protons are greater than neutrons, then there is also an instability, but that is less in comparison to when number of neutrons are greater than number of protons. Then in heavier atom, this condition is followed. So that's why, as you have seen, that the heavier the atoms which are greater than z equal to 80, then they are more unstable as the number of neutron exceeds in a large amount than the number of protons there. So also with the help of this number of neutron proton, we can show the stability. According to that, actually we can define it in the same manner, like we can designate nuclei's name, odd nuclei, even nuclei, odd even nuclei, and even odd nuclei. So this is number of proton, this is number of neutrons. Okay, so number of protons and number of neutrons in equal cases can be odd or can be even. Clear? Means both number can be odd, both number can be even. So according to that, we say the nuclei, odd nuclei and even nuclei. Also we can say odd, if z is odd and n is even, odd even nuclei. If z is even, n is odd, we can say it even odd nuclei. And with the help of these four types of categorization, we can easily explain the stability. And it has been seen that in different pair, we have different binding energy, and we have different stability of the atoms. So I think that this is actually only a brief about this, means how can we explain the stability of nucleus with the help of this. So I think all the concept regarding to the nuclei are now clear to you. According to your syllabus, I have covered all the topics like nuclear fusion, fission forces, and the exchange forces, how can we define stability and other properties of nucleus. So if all the things are clear to you, then now this chapter ends here today. In the next class, we will start a new field of physics, that is electronics, means devices. We are going to enter in the field of devices. So in the next class, let's start that and prepare this chapter also. So let's end the class here, guys. Thank you.